Hello everyone, my name is Bob Amaya, and some of you may know me as Robert, and I hope you're enjoying the Santa Clara Vanguard birthday celebration. I want to thank Rosalyn Akar for your nomination, and I'm honored to share the 2020 Hall of Fame Award with fellow alum Paul Siebert, who I had the privilege of marching with in the percussion section, and also with Mrs. Sally McGee. Well, how did I get here? I first saw the Vanguard as a spectator in 1968, and later in 1970 as a member of the Guardsmen Drum and Bugle Corps from Redwood City, California. Ironically, our instructors were current members of the Santa Clara Vanguard. But it wasn't until 1970 when I saw the Vanguard start their field show, coming out from the far right corner, expanding this wedge, playing Festive Overture by Dmitri Shostakovich and Procession of the Nobles by Rimsky-Korsakov, I was absolutely awestruck by their precision, musical ability, and their overall just performance. I said to myself, wow, I want to be a part of that. I just had a little problem and I wasn't really sure how I was going to do it. I knew I had the drive, I just wasn't sure I had the talent. So in 1972, at the encouragement of Kurt Moore, I auditioned for the cymbal line and I made it. With the support of Gail Royer, our corps director, I transitioned into the horn line and played contrabass bugle from 1973 to 1974. Gail was not only a teacher and a mentor for me, but he had this unique ability to bring out the best in you and encourage you to play with feeling and emotion. I kind of compare it to an actor. You can give anyone a script and they can read the words on the paper, but a true actor who is trained, when they read those words, they're going to make you believe that they're that character. And that's what Gail would do to all of us. He would make us play with feeling and emotion. And so I would stay in touch with Gail throughout my adult life until he passed in 1993. In 1975 and 76, so those were my last 2 years of eligibility. I had firmly made up my mind that I wasn't going to march. I was going to focus on my college career. But as we all know, things don't always happen as they're planned. And I was contacted in 1976 by Sal Salas, who was an instructor for the rifle line for the Madison Scouts. He invited me to audition and I actually made it into the line. Much to Gail's disappointment, I marched my age out year with the Scouts, but we beat the Vanguard in 1976. Being a part of the Scouts organization, much like being a part of the Vanguard family, has come back to bless me in so many ways, and I have absolutely no regrets on my decision. It wasn't until 1990 that I was in a position where I could give back to the Corps. I reached out to Gail and I asked him, what could I do? And he said, well, Bobby, and that's what he called me when I was a member, and that's what he continued to call me as an adult. He said, you can drive my vehicle on tour. I was sort of thinking, well, maybe I was just going to come and stir a pot of spaghetti. I was going to add some Kool-Aid into a cooler maybe, or I was going to do some dishes. And I started to do my homework, and I realized that there were a number of drivers who had come in and out. There were recent age outs who were a little bit intimidated by Gale and didn't return. And in fact, there was even an urban legend that a recent age out had jumped out of the vehicle on the Salt Flats in Utah and never returned. So I was thinking, wow, how hard can it really be? So I went down to the car hall and I met with the current transportation manager, Bud Romo. Bud said, "Hey, Bob, I just want to let you know that we've got Gale a new vehicle. It's called a Bounder." I'm like, "Okay, what's a Bounder?" He said, "It's a RV mobile home that's about 5 feet shorter than a commercial bus. So you're not going to need any type of special license." I'm thinking to myself, "Hey, Bud, I drive a Honda Civic. It's about the size of a shoebox. And how is that going to work?" So he just reassured me. He said, "You know, go ahead, get out there. Drive it around the block a couple times around the core hall and get a feel for it." So I get into it. I'm immediately reaching for the rearview mirror. It's not there. I'm looking for that back window to look out when I'm backing up. Not there. I get onto that big wheel and I'm navigating to get out of the driveway. And I took it around Space Park Drive and around the core hall about three times. I can't tell you how intimidated I was by that vehicle. But I managed to maneuver back in. It took me about a city block to get that thing back into the parking lot of the core hall. And I thought, you know what? I'm up for the game. I'm up for the challenge. So I drove Gale from 1990 until he retired in 1992. I cherish those memories and those stories that we shared on those long drives. And I'll share one of those special moments with you in just a few moments. When Gale passed in 1993, I drove for Suvies. I later sold merchandise, took sewing lessons so I could work on uniforms with some amazing people. And I love this woman who headed up the uniforms program, Jan Clay. I also want to apologize to any of you who are marching members if you were a victim of my tailoring skills. And in 2008, I took on the core hall as a project. I asked Jeff Feeler, the current executive director, if I could update the pictures, change out the displays, archive our memorabilia and uniforms, which I continue to do today. But none of these projects that I've mentioned right now would have been possible if it wasn't for a particular individual, and that is my partner, Erwin Brookhuis. When I met Erwin in 2008, like I'm sure many of you who've met your significant other or somebody important in your life, and you try to explain to them what this crazy thing is you do, and they think you're in the circus, and you're afraid that they're going to run out the door and never come back. Well, I didn't have to explain why I drove cross country, took cold showers with strangers, ate peanut butter and jelly every summer. Erwin was from the Midwest and he performed in high school band. So he was already familiar with drum corps. And I have to share with you that he's one of Vanguard's biggest fans and supporters. And if it weren't for his love and support and generosity, just being a general all around good guy and a jack of all trades, none of this would have been possible for me. And so, you're going to see photos that have Erwin in the majority of photos, and you're probably going to think, "Hey, this guy, he's doing all the work. How did you get the award?" Well, someone's got to be the supervisor and take the pictures. So as I mentioned earlier, I wanted to share with you a conversation that Gale and I had on one of our drives in the summer of 1990. Gale would always play classical music on or opera on the CD player. And one night he was listening to a beautiful opera that I wasn't familiar with. I asked him what it was, and he said it was the Italian opera Turandot by Puccini. And I asked if he would narrate the story for me. Later, he confided that he wanted the corps to play the music. I, on the other hand, would play ad nauseum the soundtrack from a recent Broadway hit musical, Miss Saigon. He asked me, "What is this you're always listening to?" He asked me what the program was about, and I told him, and he actually mentioned, I forgot to say this, that he thought it was similar that there was a similar sound to Les Mis. I didn't get that in the beginning. I explained to him that the setting was a plot in 1970s Saigon during the Vietnam War. And ironically, it was based on Puccini's 1904 opera, Madame Butterfly. What I later learned was that Miss Saigon was a musical by Claude Michel Schomburg and Alain Boubil. And the music was Schomburg and Boubil's second major success following Les Mis in 1985. Well, that explained to me why Gail thought it sounded familiar. And I said to Gail, I think the Corps should play Miss Saigon. That was my plan. And I played that thing until we wore it out. Later on that year, many of you don't know that Gail would take a long vacation to somewhere exotic, somewhere like sometimes in Eastern Europe. And he sent me a letter that he was from London, that he was watching Miss Saigon. And he said, I think we're going to do your play. And well, I guess the rest is history. It's been an honor and a privilege to give back to an organization that's had such a profound influence on my life. Thank you, everyone. I hope that you enjoy your evening, and happy birthday, Santa Clara Vanguard. Good night.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kathy McGee Pearson, and my mom, Sally McGee, was an inductee into the 2020 Santa Clara Vanguard Hall of Fame. She passed away just about a year ago, but I was able to share the news of this incredible honor with her. Her smile said it all to me about how much it meant to her. I would like to share with you a little bit about my mom and her contribution to the Vanguard. She began volunteering in 1978 when my older sister Christine joined the Color Guard. I followed in 1979, and the entire McGee family became part of the organization. My parents were a mainstay of the Booster Club and volunteered in many ways over the 10 years that we marched. My dad worked Friday night bingo every week and was a Vanguard historian for a couple of years. My mom volunteered in many ways, maybe most significantly as uniform chairman in the early 1980s. From 1977 through 1980, the Corps was split between green tunics for percussion and red tunics for brass, as they were unable to get any more red material to match what they had. In 1981, it was decided to make all new tops. My mom, as uniform chairman, took on that challenge, and the sewing crew made red tunics for the entire drum corps with white rather than green stripes. Partway through the season, there was concern that the white stripes were too exposed, showing off every interval error. Too many ticks. They needed to go back to the green stripes. My mom and her crew made a full set of green stripe overlays to go on every single tunic, having to hand match them to every member, every tunic, and two stars. They made them removable, and the Corps ripped them off during the closure after the gun for field judging sounded. You gotta love that Velcro. We used a lot of it in the 80s. My mom, being the ultimate planner that she was, made sure to get lots of extra material of that same red dye lot to keep them going for many years to come. Those tunics lasted nearly a decade. But uniform chairman did not just mean making uniforms. It also included making the color guard flags, top among them, the iconic V flags. One of my mom's favorite stories was in 1982 when Lenny Kruzecki, the guard instructor, wanted to update the V flags, making a green-red version in addition to the red-green version. The sewing crew was swamped, but Lenny said he had a seamstress who could sew anything and the Corps would pay her to make the flags. My mom was skeptical and a little annoyed, feeling that Len was slighting her and her crew, but dutifully packed up the pattern and material for one flag. He shipped it off to his super seamstress. 3 weeks later, it came back in pieces with her saying, she said it's impossible and there's no way that she can make this flag. Lenny basically begged my mom to figure out how to get the flags done, which of course she did. And he treated her a little better after that. There were many more crazy flags that she helped prototype, pattern, and sew. Sunshine flags, skyline flags, mesh flags, wave flags, just to name a few. She did not do this alone and had great help along the way. Judy Smith stepped in to take the lead on the guard costumes, and Elaine Kono, another Hall of Fame member, takes over from uniform chairman as my mom in the mid 80s. In 1984 was the introduction of the white slammin' pants that were only worn for big shows. Green pants were used for the rest. I can't tell you how many loads of pants my mom washed that summer. In 1985, I remember having pants torn apart and Velcro everywhere in my mom's sewing room as they worked through the prototypes and the production of the magic pants. Not to mention parachutes, tunnels, and lots of other things. She measured and fitted the members, made alterations, and worked tirelessly to make sure the core looked its best. It was the interaction with the members that was her favorite part. She loved to remind me that she met my husband, Jeff, before I did, when she measured him for his first Vanguard uniform. In addition to uniforms, my mom and dad did civvies for part of the 1981 summer tour. Good thing for me, as I most likely would have been sent home when I injured my knee if my parents hadn't already been there. My mom also helped out on Miss Amana going on tour in 1986. In the early 80s, in order to march the drum corps, you had to live in the Santa Clara area beginning in January for 3 rehearsals a week. The drum corps was starting to see the beginning of imports, and my mom opened her home to them, embracing the role of drum corps mom. What I've come to realize over the years is the impact she had on those and other members, how her actions inspired them to be better people, to give back, to be the Vanguard. That is the legacy that makes me the most proud. With that, I wanted you to hear from some of them, not just from me. We also lost my dad this year, and in early December, we were able to hold a virtual memorial service for both of them. Janice spoke so eloquently of her McGee moments, and I wanted to share a few of those with you. Caroline Enriquez first met my mom during her days at Rebel Cadets. She was part of our carpool and became another of my mom's adopted kids.
I was 19 years old when I first met Mr. and Mrs. McGee. It was 82 going into 1983. About 3/4 of my Vanguard adventure, I found myself in a bit of a housing crisis and possibly homeless. I thought I was only hours away from buying a one-way plane ticket home to Boston when I got a call from a friend saying that the McGees were willing to let me stay with them for the duration of the drum corps season. I was shocked and relieved. Now that I look back, this is my first McGee moment. They had saved me from losing my lifetime dream of being a member of the Santa Clara Vanguard. And I really didn't even know the McGees at that point. We had just exchanged niceties, maybe at the corps hall or coming and going from practices. I was a bit nervous about this new adventure, but it didn't last long. As soon as I walked in their home, I knew we were going to be family. Our relationship grew that year and beyond. I treasure all the moments that I had with them in the house in Los Gatos. My moments with Mrs. McGee were spent in her sewing room, where she would make horn-lined uniforms and flags and even a parachute. She would sew and I would talk. These were my Mrs. McGee mentor moments. It was a lot of her saying, mm-hmm, and are you sure you want to do that? And Janice, you just need to learn to ignore Lenny. Because of the kindness the McGee showed me, my parents were able to sleep and find peace knowing that I was safe so far away from them. When the drum corps season was over, I left California and returned home to the East Coast. We would stay in contact by phone, always aware of the long distance charges, so Mrs. McGee had set hours and days I could call. It would be 9 years before we saw each other again. I returned as a married woman and a mom of 2 children, and to celebrate the 25th anniversary of Vanguard. Every time I returned to California, my first stop was always to see the McGees. It might have been a drive-by visit, or it might have been a dinner where we would catch up. but I guarantee you it was going to be Chinese food. I've never met two people who love Chinese food more than these two. In 1994, they traveled back east to watch me perform in alumni corps with the 27th Lancers. It always makes me chuckle that they traveled 3,000 miles away to see me spin a flag for 15 minutes. But with everything there is in life, there's always a McGee moment. Because of the example set by the McGees, I learned to pay it forward in life. Over the years, we have opened our own home to strangers and friends in need. Some wanted to march back here, or as I refer to them as, they just want to spin, dance, and repeat. I sat on the board at our local high school and supported the teenage pregnancy program and outreach. I would return to Vanguard in 2012-ish and go on tour as a support medical person, of which I did that twice. For 38 years, I stayed in touch with the McGees. Thank you for all my McGee moments.
Hi, I'd like to thank Kathy and Christine for inviting me to share memories of their mother. Mrs. McGee was an amazing woman. She was caring, loving, supportive, intelligent. She was a Stanford graduate, a force to be reckoned with, frugal, disciplined, up for any challenge that she knew she could solve. And most of all, she loved the Vanguard. We had maybe six different flags in a show, and Sally really organized the cutting and sewing of all the flags, and it was quite a job. She was always happy to do it. There was never a deadline or an ask that she couldn't meet, and she was always eager to do what was right for all of us. She loved the Corps as much as we did, and it was so fun to have a mom that was into it as much as we were. And, you know, back in those days, it was our life, and it seemed like it was her life as well. I'm so thrilled that Sally's been inducted into the Hall of Fame. And one of the things that I really want to give Sally credit for was bringing process and integrity to the Star. Sally innately knew that the Star was coveted, and if we wanted a Star, a new Star, we had to turn in our old Star. And if your Star was broken, you had to turn in all the broken pieces. So you couldn't say, you know, your dog ate it and, you know, show up with no Star and then get a Star. So because the Stars, she kept such a tight wrap on the Stars, they became very coveted. The only time we ever wore them was on our uniform. At prelims and finals, we had brand new Stars. And I know Sally was always excited when the shiny new Stars came and she could hand them out to the members. I'm so proud of all the work that Sally did for the organization, and I'm so grateful for the time that she shared with me. And as you can tell, I'm really happy to talk about her this evening. And I'm so glad that she's been inducted into the Vanguard Hall of Fame. Thank you so much.
I think Janice summed it up so well in her support of my mom's nomination. It was the life lessons, dedication, and commitment that I witnessed from Mrs. McGee that taught me about what happens behind the applause and the name on the truck that are crucial to any organization being successful and to remain in awe of those in the activity. My mom's love and devotion to her daughters became a love and devotion to the organization and the kids that she housed, fed, clothed, and cheered for over the years with the Vanguard. Thank you so much for listening about my mom, and thank you so much for honoring her in this way.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Paul Siebert's Hall of Fame video. My name is Kurt Moore, and I am a Hall of Fame member, and I've been instructed to put together a video that you will be watching at the Hall of Fame dinner and celebration, which is always in March. And We have two really fun guests that are helping me out today, and I want to introduce first one of the great people I've ever known in my life, and one of the founding members of the Santa Clara Vanguard drumline and a member of the Corps. Today we have with us Jeff Leeson. Thanks for being here, Jeff.
No problem, Kurt.
And he's got some things he wants to share about Paul, and it worked out just at the last second that Jeff could join us, and it's absolutely perfect that he's here, because he was here when Paul first got in the drumline. Our other guest is my dearest friend and great drummer, was with the Vanguard as a performer for 3 years, 1974, 75, 76, and as a staff member teaching the Corps in 86 and 87, my good friend Alan Christensen.
Hey, Kurt.
Hey, glad to have you here. And by the way, I didn't mention... Jeff, you marched in the Vanguard what years?
I marched in 67, 68, and 69.
Wow.
Yeah. Do you ever get tired of hearing the word wow?
Yeah, the dinosaurs from off the earth, I think, yeah.
At that
point.
Oh, man.
And I was there from the Sparks. We were carryovers from the Sparks from 64, 65, 66 is when I marched with the Sparks. But the other drummers that were in the Sparks in the early days, Mike Wall and Harry White and myself, we had played drums together for probably about 6 or 7 years, and then into the Vanguard, 67, 68. And then Paul came in 1969. And Fred Sanford's goal was to have 4 snares and 4 tenors. And we were working our butts off and we had everything going. We were ready. And Harry, for some reason, decided to depart the scene, and we landed up with just the three of us. And Harry comes in as a 14-year-old, and I'll give Paul so much credit because he was such a young guy. He comes into an established drum line of a bunch of old guys. And I felt there was a lot of intimidation there, but he held his own, and he was a strong drummer.
So you were there when Paul first stepped in, and you and I talked earlier, and he was about 14 years old when he stepped into the Vanguard snare line.
Yeah, 14 years old he came in, and at the time I'm 20. I'm only about 5 months away from 21. Mike Wall was 20. Harry White was 20. So he comes into the snare line as a 14-year-old kid. He came from a little drum corps in San Jose. I believe we chatted about that. At first, I thought it was the Night Raiders, but it turned out to be the Rebels.
Right.
And, I felt sorry for the guy. I mean, he was all eyes and all ears. I mean, he listened. He never commented. He never talked back to anybody.
So we have to kind of keep moving here. And the idea is to give people a sense of who Paul Siebert was and why he was inducted into the Hall of Fame, which was last year in 2020. So Paul is part of the 2020 inductees, and because of our COVID situation, we didn't really get a chance to do much with this. So that's why we're here today. For those who don't know, which is generations after, you know, Jeff and Alan and I, Paul Siebert is somebody who represents the cream of the crop, and somebody who was part of a foundation that only people in the beginning of an organization, in the beginning, there's always the first who came along. And, you know, just by definition of the beginning of any kind of organization, and Paul was part of that. He played snare drum for the through kind of a crossing of eras. And Jeff and I marched in the era of the Green Blouses, which is the first 5 years. And Paul was part of that for 3 years and then played with the red tunics, the new uniforms, for 4 years. So he marched a total of 7 years in the snare line. And he was probably, we all agreed that he was the gold standard of center snares. And he when he was 14 and marching in the Vanguard, he was a little kid. But within a few years, starting around 1971, when Bob Kalkofen came to teach the Vanguard, he knew Paul was the right guy to be the center snare. And
Major Tim Moxley, all the way from Santa Clara, California, the Santa Clara Vanguard.
Of the Vanguard percussion program is really quite something, and something that all of us who are part of the Vanguard, part of the marching percussion program, are really quite taken with and very proud of. I mean, we're all proud of it because we're there, but yet we're all kind of watching it just like everybody else, just kind of going, oh my goodness, this thing is really taking off. So Paul ends up aging out after 75. And that was his last year marching with the Vanguard. And then he ended up going to the Seattle Imperials to teach and marched his last year of eligibility there. But his participation in the drumline from 1969 to 1975 is just absolutely historic. And as Jeff will attest, as he was there watching all these years, and Alan and I were marching together, the drumline rose to prominence in really quite an extraordinary fashion. And we had a great time, and we set some records. We won 54 shows in a row, 2 years undefeated. And when you have a group of really extraordinary individuals, especially drummers, you have a lot of headstrong people. And all of us, I think, are amazed at how strong Paul was in a very sort of quiet and silent way, led by example. So there's a lot of reasons why he was nominated to the Hall of Fame, but the real basic important ones are that he was part of that group of people who were there in the beginning, and he was absolutely part of the foundation that we all stood on that led to this tremendous rise of the Vanguard percussion program, which is, you know, pretty world famous, nationally famous for the percussion program. It's gone through its ups and downs in the last few years. It's found itself back on top again. But that first initial rise was really something that was a marvel to watch and be a part of. Alan, you were there in 74, 75, and 76, and of course you taught the Corps. Any particular things stand out for you about Paul?
Well, that, you know, you just mentioned guys in the line that were extremely good and headstrong and to a degree very arrogant. And that was the opposite of Paul. Paul was so humble and kind, yet he was focused and was consistent as ever.
Like a laser.
Yeah, it was just incredible. And you know, before I got in the Corps, I marched in the Night Raiders, and you know, I heard of Paul, and I had met Paul in County Honor Band. And so I knew about him, and boy, there was just this this feeling that he was some sort of a god. And he wasn't. He was just down to earth. But man, when you're in rehearsal, he was just so strong and focused and set on playing exactly the same way every single time. And he was so easy to follow, and he was just a strong leader as far as that goes, and the epitome of leaders that you would want to be a head snare. And that's why the Corps and the drumline became so strong so quickly, is because of his consistency and his attitude, and that he didn't demean anyone. Everybody, when they were under Paul, it was to play, and nobody could question what Paul did. He was just so consistent. And
he was a consistent person too. Like you said, he just led by example. And in those years that we aged out of 74, 75, and things were moving so fast and we were flying so high as a drumline and an organization, it can get really tricky to keep track of who you are. It can get tricky to keep track of who we are. Things can easily fall off the rails because of the immense enormity of the motion going forward that we had. And Paul Siebert was this kind of Yoda-like personality in the middle of the snare line that do you remember his nickname?
Crazy glue.
Exactly. Exactly. And do you remember who came up with that? Was that Thomas?
No, I don't remember.
Okay. Yeah. So Paul Siebert's, one of his nicknames was Crazy Glue because he was that strong as a leader that it was, he was like the crazy glue that held everything together. He won championships as a solo snare drummer, and I remember him practicing day in and day out for those championships. And Al and I were just talking that he had won a championship as a tenor drummer, and he played a snare drum solo and turned the snares off. that's how he won the tenor championship.
You're right.
So anyway, we are more than proud and happy to have our group of people here to talk about Paul Siebert. We hope that when you click on this video, you'll learn a few things about him. He was the gold standard of what is a center snare back in those days, and then transitioned into the 80s and the 90s and the 2000s, that I think the idea of that person in the middle became so standard, became such a normal thing that nobody really thought, you know, a lot about it. But back in those days, maybe not so much. And Paul became that person that was in the middle of one of the greatest drum lines in history. So anyway, enjoy your time at the banquet and the celebration online. And I'd like to thank Alan Christensen, my dear friend. And by the way, always on my side. Alan and I march right next to each other. I always count him. And Jeff Leeson, Jeff Leeson was like another Yoda personality to me, because when I was teaching, and he'd come up and he'd stand next to me, and he always had this great look on his face, and he'd say, "Hey, how's it going?" And we'd have just a really great chat. And Jeff Leeson was sort of like this unofficial person on the staff that was sort of like, you know, looking out for the best interests of everybody that he was around. So, Jeff, thank you for that.
Yeah. Great.
So, all here to celebrate Paul Siebert Hall of Fame Award. Thanks very much, and we'll see you later.
Thank you to the Santa Clara Vanguard for this great honor. Gail Royer hired me in 1983 as a brass instructor who had never touched a bugle before. Later, he turned over part of the arranging duties, starting with the 1988 Phantom of the Opera show. I would like to thank everyone who served on brass staff with me over the years. Tim Salzman, who convinced Gail it'd be a good idea to hire me, and in the previous 2 years, it set up the brass program in a new direction that would lead to success for the next decade. Rick South, the warm-up guru of all time, whose sofa I slept on for 7 summers, and John Figuero, who was part of the crew that brought the first Jim Ott Memorial High Brass Trophy to SCV in 1984. Other brass instructors included Marty Reese, Tim Andrees, Steve Barnhill, Chris Knowles, Dean Westman, Chris Mora, Tony Castro, Brian Belsky, Jed Weeks, Dave Beck, Larry Dastrup, Rich Armstrong, Dustin Winston, Sly Sibilski, Eric Hand, and I'm sure I've left a few names out. Some of the percussion designers and instructors I worked with included Ralph Hardiman, Scott Johnson, Jim Casella, Glenn Crosby, Kent Cater, and Kurt Moore. And thank you to all the other instructional staff, support staff, and drum majors over the years. I learned a lot from Ralph while sitting on top of the equipment truck running ensemble rehearsals year after year. One thing was that when the batteries ran low on Dr. Beat, the tempos would slow down, so you had to set it to a higher tempo. No wonder tempos kept getting faster through the season, and I fell for it every summer. I'd also like to thank Murray Gussick for naming one of his exercises after me, Flash Gordon Henderson. The first time I ever saw the Corps live was in 1974 at the Bluegrass Nationals in Richmond, Kentucky. The Corps came onto the field, warmed up, and then it started pouring rain, and they left the field. So it wasn't until the 1976 DCI Finals in Philadelphia that I saw the Corps perform, and I've been a fan ever since. In 1983, I walked into the first rehearsal with monster lead sopranos Mike McWilliams, Ron Abadam, and Kevin Kono, looking at me with the vibe, "So you're going to be our instructor? You better have your act together." I flew into Montreal to join the Corps on tour, only to find out there was no room for me on the staff van. Initially, I wasn't happy about being put on the drum bus, but by the time we crossed the border and arrived in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, I was pretty happy to have missed that particular ride on the staff van. You'll have to ask someone who was there. In 1984, after robbing the Corps of Mike, Kevin, and Ron when I got them into the Olympic band that summer, we had to develop 15 and 16-year-olds like Chuck McKinnon and Rich Armstrong in the lead sopranos, then getting a bunch of older rookies in and eventually winning high brass with a horn line whose average age was barely over 17. In 1985, while sitting in my office at UCLA, a student named Franz Harari came by and asked if he could design some magic tricks to incorporate to my band shows like he had as an undergraduate student at the University of Michigan. I said yes, and I told him there was a drum corps director I wanted him to talk to. From 1985 to 1989, SCV featured several of his illusions that made an indelible impression on audiences. Franz became famous for his work on numerous TV shows, the Michael Jackson Victory Tour, the Super Bowl, and stage shows around the world. At the Memorial Day camp in Oroville in 1986, the horn line had a surprise for Tim Salzman when he arrived. After one of Tim's serious, inspiring talks, when he gave the first downbeat, the horn line broke into an arrangement of Robert Palmer's Addicted to Love, a video that we had watched numerous times on MTV at Rick's house. 1987 was an amazing year with a great horn line, SCV's second Jim Ott Trophy, a great show, and a nearly perfect season. Also, starting that year for the next two seasons as visual coordinator, I was involved with developing the visual aspects of the programs. 1988 was generally a tough year, starting with a show at Live Oak High School in a dust storm and the full corps wearing long black capes that were then promptly discarded. It was our first try at Phantom, and it needed tons of changes throughout the summer. Illness hit the corps in mid-tour, and the corps marched many holes for over a week. At DCI South, it appeared that we were safely ahead of the Madison Scouts, but catching the Blue Devils seemed to be out of our reach. Then something amazing happened. People often talk about the magical performances of the corps, but the most magical moment I ever felt with the corps was on a practice field carved out of a cornfield in the middle of nowhere at the rehearsal the night before semis in Kansas City. Everything came together that night and everyone in the corps and staff felt it. It was almost like the corps was performing a few inches above the ground and was communicating the emotion of the show effortlessly. And we almost pulled it off the next two nights. You might remember that that was the year that they pulled names of judges out of a hat for finals that didn't quite work out for us. Finally, after four straight second places, we took the championship in 1989. There was quite a bit of pressure involved in meeting the expectations going into that season, but the Corps believed in the show and was able to fend off some tremendous competitors. 1990 might have been the strongest soprano section from top to bottom that I ever worked with at SCB. 1991 was an interesting year with massive rewrites throughout the season, but Miss Saigon ended up being an iconic SCB show with memorable percussion effects. 1996 to 1999 felt like one long season moving ever closer to the championship until we got there in 1999. We stole Dean Westman from the Cavaliers to run the horn line, and I was able to concentrate more on design. I felt as though percussion designer Jim Casillo was the driving force behind each of these shows, and he inspired us to make the Corps a title contender. The music for the 1999 show seemed as though we might be going a little too far out on a limb. We had considered the minimalistic Canyon by Philip Glass for a few years before taking it on that year. I remember standing next to Casella at the March camp and saying that we would either win or not make finals. The Barber music for the middle of the show was suggested by Jed Weeks, and it worked great. Blue Shades was brought in by Casella, who saw the potential for it and was unafraid of it being too jazzy. The success of Hear Ye the year before helped to set up Blue Shades for success. After that, I made a few other guest appearances with the Corps, most notably coming in to compose Trivandrum, the opener for the 2002 season, which was an adaptation from another piece. Working with the Santa Clara Vanguard was a great time to help the Corps create amazing performances, travel all over the country, and to make numerous lifelong friends. It also gave me the chance to recruit some great students to come to UCLA, and I brought some UCLA students up to join the Corps. Being a part of SCV created some wonderful opportunities for me to work with groups throughout Asia, most notably the Aimachi Band from Nagoya, Japan, and to serve as a clinician and judge at events all over the world. Good times.
Hi, everybody. Good evening and happy birthday, SCV. It is a great honor to be inducted into the Vanguard Hall of Fame. I have been blessed and lucky to be involved with the organization for 28 years and counting, and to be recognized alongside the esteemed group of individuals already in the Hall of Fame is truly humbling. They have impacted the organization and the activity beyond measure. I must also express my deep gratitude to those who submitted my nomination and took the time to write in letters of support. My involvement with SCV started in 1993 when I joined the Vanguard Cadets and was in the front ensemble. The previous summer, I had seen my first DCI videotape, 91 Vanguard Miss Saigon, an amazing show, and I was instantly hooked. I knew this was something that I had to do. My second year in the Vanguard Cadets, I moved over to play bass drum. In 1995, I joined the A Corps, where I continued to play bass drum until I aged out in 1999. My marching career spanned 7 years, and I was fortunate to be taught by some great people. Jim Casella, Murray Gusick, Kent Cater, J.W. Kester, Myron Rosander, and many, many others. As members, we were scrappy. We worked hard, and we built upon our efforts each year. I have to give a special shout out to my brothers and sisters with whom I marched. Each of you influenced me and inspired me in many ways. We sweated together, we laughed, we cried, we lost, and we won. You were all responsible for my work ethic, inner fire, and drive for excellence. My transition into supporter of the Corps actually started during my last year marching in 99, when I finished remodeling the previous A Corps equipment truck during the winter and spring. That project, along with putting some of the first bunks in the staff buses before heading out on tour, started my post-member involvement, which continues today. The focus of my time helping the organization has generally been in the areas of the fleet, marketing, and technology. In 2000, I started working for the organization part-time for a few years. I would go on tour all summer driving the lead vehicle and doing repairs on the road. I also taught the Vanguard Cadets from 2000 to 2001. And in 2004, I helped put the dance floor in the Horn and Guard room. I also took over the website in 2000, including implementing the first online store for the Corps to sell merchandise. In 2008, I designed and built MySCV, the part of the website that houses the Corps' online membership portal and database. Members use it to register for auditions and camps and pay membership fees, and the staff uses it to track rosters, finances, and audition grades. On top of that, I'm also a member of the fleet team. We get together on a monthly basis to perform the preventative maintenance on the vehicles, trailers, and generators, and do other repairs as needed. We periodically tackle bigger infrastructure projects, like building an entirely new ACOR equipment trailer in 2011, and most recently, designing the new Miss Amana in 2019. However, everything I just mentioned was done with the help of many additional people. I cannot take all the credit and must also recognize some key contributors. Terry Maurer, Mike Drotz, Dan Vanetta, George Brown, Rick Valenzuela, Don Corbett, Cale Dupree, and Charles Frost. I have learned so much from each of them during my time with the organization, and their support has been invaluable. When I think about what the Vanguard means to me and what has kept me staying involved year after year, it comes down to three main reasons. First, I have always felt the calling to give back and enable the current and future members to have the same amazing experience as I did. I want this organization and its benefits to those who participate to long outlast me. As a member, you learn to live with each other and work together to push past barriers and difficult times and better yourself every day. You develop a work ethic, a deep focus, and a desire for excellence. And perhaps most importantly, you get to see your efforts, energy, and performance affecting the people in the stands and inspiring them every night. Those are incredible life experiences that you get to take with you long after you've stopped marching. I've benefited greatly from them, and I want to help make sure those opportunities continue to exist for future members. The second reason is the enjoyment I get from being able to put my passions and hobbies to good use. Since I was a little kid, I've always enjoyed working with my hands and building things. When I'm working on projects for the Corps, whether it's creating the website or building the equipment truck or replacing the air brake fitting under Miss Amana on the side of the road in the middle of the night on tour, they never feel like work. They are all fun projects where I get to be creative, inventive, and resourceful. I may not be on a field playing a drum anymore, but I still get to express myself and feed my soul to the benefit of the organization. And finally, the deep friendships and family I have developed over the years. One of the most amazing things about the Drum Corps is how you can see someone again after 5, 10, or 20 years and pick up and feel like not a day has passed. You have a special bond with them. There are so many people I have gotten to perform with and work with over the years in the activity that I am truly grateful for each and every one of them. I hope that by sharing some of my past experience and reasons why I continue to be involved with the Vanguard will help inspire other people to do the same. While there are inevitably some people that get recognized out of the masses, this is truly a team activity, and without the help of everyone, the volunteers, instructors, drivers, support staff, office staff, and so many more, the members couldn't do what they do best: learn, grow, perform, and entertain. I can't thank all of you enough for your efforts. In closing, I want to again thank the Hall of Fame committee and the members of the Hall of Fame for this extraordinary honor. And to everyone out there in Vanguard land, I hope that you and your families remain safe and healthy, and I look forward to celebrating Vanguard's birthday next year in person with you all. Thank you, and go Vanguard.
You ready to go?
Yeah, here. I have a gift for you.
Oh.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Terribly.
Spell your name right and everything?
Yeah. I want to start out by just saying thank you, everyone who's involved with this, and what an incredible honor this is. It's unbelievable to be inducted with Pete and Ralph and Kurt and Fred and Mrs. A and Kevin's mother. And Terry Maurer, and you know, all the incredible people that have made this organization what it is.
Let's talk about your little bit of history here. You joined when in 78, right?
I joined in 78. The thing that's really incredible about this story, I think, when I was in high school, Pete Romo and Kevin McAllister came to our high school, Sunnyvale High School, and blew our minds, you know, and they were young guys, and they just came in to help out. But, you know, that little thing, to just that little amount that they came in, it was probably a couple of weeks, just, you know, changed all of our lives. And so then I joined, and, you know, like many stories, I didn't make it. I was not accepted. I sat down with Jay Jordan and Phil Olds. At the time, you know, and I said, you know, hey, you know, can I stick around and hang out? And they were kind of like, no, you pretty much suck bad enough, you know. And right at that specific moment, Gail walked by.
Yeah.
And he was like, you know, what's going on here? You know, and so I repeated my request, and he's like, yeah, go ahead. You know, he can stick around.
That's how a 17-year-old sax player elbows his way into a DCI championship.
Well, you know, that's the thing about the beauty about the Vanguard and about drum corps is it's group activity.
You know, there's so many core guys. When I came in 81, mm-hmm. was my first and only year marching. And when I came in, I saw, it was like a look in the eyes of the guys in the horn line. And then all those guys, I just felt like they took their cues from you.
You know, it wasn't taking the cues from me. It may have felt like that. And I assumed the role, my role within that group. And I know that my role was a leadership role. So I did what I needed to do, which was yell at you and yell at Mitch and, you know, Pat Crandall and, you know, whoever else was there. But really what really I think was represented in that moment that you came in, because you were 81, was really this transformation for me in how I see the drum corps experience and the drum corps story, or the Vanguard story, is that, you know, 80 was one of the most incredible years ever. Right. And I've been around drum corps a long time and seen a lot of drum corps. It's still incredible to this day. Yep. It was incredible then. It was brutal then. We were the first drum corps ever to take seventh place. We, you know, felt bad about ourselves in a lot of ways. We felt proud of ourselves in a lot of ways. We knew we were doing something different. We just took a beating, you know, we lost to Spirit of Atlanta, you know, which was, you know, it's all, you know, it was beautiful. Yeah. It was really a beautiful thing, but, you know, coming into 81, there was a cleaning of the house. There was a new energy. There was a new excitement. Uh-huh. And guys like Fig was a huge part of this story. Fig and my story was really in my year, you know, uh-huh. just, you know, laying it down and being really clear about what his intentions were. And that came through me. And, you know, 81 was the shift of what I would say of kind of what I would describe as the old drum corps, the old Vanguard, which was really this Vanguard that was, you know, superstars. But we were the guys who were the first guys to run. Like, we would run before rehearsals and we would set that up ourselves. And we were the first guys to do, you know, push-ups, not as a punishment, but as a celebration. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of that story has to do with the fact that 80, what we did and what we went through in 80. And a lot of it has to do with Chaz. You know, Chaz was, sorry, got emotional. Chaz was, as you know, Chaz was a huge part of our shift. And, and to really believe in ourselves and that we could take things and do things further. Everybody was that way. Everyone was saying those things. Everyone was sharing that information. And you know, but that was a big deal.
You know, I think if 81 was a so-so year, you would have had a different trend line than you ended up with Santa Clara. And in the end, 81 begat 82 and 83 and not all the way to 89 with another championship. The 80s, the Santa Clara Vanguard was just a phenomenal organization.
Yeah.
What they put on the field was just every year, which one was better? It's the flip of a coin. You mentioned the staff. Mm-hmm. And the staff during your era, when you were in the Corps and on the podium, mm-hmm. you had Pete Emmons, Fred Sanford, Ralph Hardiman, you mentioned Salzman, Charlie Anderson. Man, it's on and on and on.
Yeah.
What was it like to be, you know, running a rehearsal when Pete's cleaning the drill or Ralph's doing his thing with the tempos in the opener and just all those things? That must have been, you had the best seat in the house.
Yeah, when they weren't in my way.
Yeah.
No, man, it was unbelievable. I think that
yeah.
You know, those guys were incredible, and Fred was particularly awesome, and Pete was the same way. You know, just so passionate and so talented. We were just, you know, Gail was unbelievable. Fred had part of that story in there. You know, it was a magical time. So we were all very blessed, you know, to do Planets, to do Kachaturian, to do, you know, Young Person's Guide, to do Count Basie in 1980. To stand in front of those drum corps, to be in front of them and to watch people perform. I mean, I had the best seat in the house. I was really fortunate. It was a very fortunate, unbelievable experience to have been with those corps, to be a part of the team of everyone that we all were. You know, the other part of the story too is that, you know, we had amazing color guards. Yeah. You know, and amazing people in those color guards with Leslie and Michelle and Diane and Honey and Kathy and Linda and, you know, just like endless beautiful yeah. people who were so sweet and so talented, and Sherry McGinnis and Lisa, and, you know, I mean, unbelievable. Yeah. I mean, just an unbelievable time, and an unbelievable opportunity, and a great blessing. Where I am now in accepting this is accepting this kind of on behalf of our crew.
Sure, sure.
All you guys that came in from the Midwest, all the guys that were there that preceded me, you know, Fig was huge. Rick yep. South was huge. Yep. You know, all those guys that, you know, that formed the group, they were, you know, everyone lifted each other up. But this, for me, this Hall of Fame thing really is about our crew making it into the Hall of Fame.